This show's called Storytellers, and I'll sing a couple of verses of a song that you might know. Message in a bottle. Send an SOS to the world. I hope that someone gets my. I hope that someone gets my. I hope that someone gets my message in my bottle. Message in my bottle. As you probably know, if you live in a big city, it's very easy to live in, surrounded by millions of people and to feel isolated. And I've always had a sort of Robinson Crusoe fantasy, you know, that I feel loneliness at the same time, I kind of relish it. Which is pretty misanthropic, really. I don't really like people that much. But that's where this song came from. So. The first verse is, you know, it's about a castaway on a desert island, and the song is kind of like a sea shanty in that, you know, the lines end with O, like C-O and me-O and B-O and whatever. And then the second verse, it's more about a sort of psychological reality of those wounded in love, you know, existential loneliness, if you like. It's always been my belief that songwriting is good therapy. Particularly for those who are emotionally challenged, let me put it that way. And I'll explain it like this. There are certain rules for songwriting. You have a verse, a chorus, a second verse, a chorus, what's called a middle eight, which I'll explain later, or a bridge. Then you have a third verse, a chorus, and a coda, which is the play out. So having established this character who's feeling lonesome, in the first two verses, I don't want to just repeat myself in the third verse. You know, there's the guy's crying in his beer for the third verse. That's boring. What happens with the structure of a song is it forces you to propel a story, if you like. There has to be some kind of development, and this is what the middle eight is. The bridge illuminates a change of mood, a change of heart, and you find yourself telling stories. Automatically, just by obeying the rules of songwriting. So we'll start. I'll go back to the third verse now. So you'll hear some sort of development. You've heard how miserable this guy is, and this is how I developed it.
Walked out this morning. I don't believe what I saw. 100 billion bottles washed out. Seems I'm not alone at being alone. 100 billion cast away, looking for a home. I'll send an SOS to the world. I'll send an SOS to the world. I hope that someone gets my. I hope that someone gets my. I hope that someone gets my message in a bottle, yeah. Message in a bottle. Message in a bottle. I'm sending out an SOS. I'm sending out an SOS. Sending out an SOS. Sending out an SOS.
Roxanne, you're very kind to me.
Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you. And every single day, and every word you say, every game you play, every to me.
There we go again. I've set up this situation of this character who's terminally miserable. I'm not a manic depressive, I have to tell you. There's absolutely nothing original about it. And yet, the song has enormous power, and I say this with all modesty. And I try and work out why, and I think the reason is it's because it's very ambiguous, this song. I wrote it initially as a seductive love song. And yet, my life began to invade the song unconsciously, because at the time I wrote this song, my life was seemed to be falling apart. I was very successful at the time, and yet my band was falling apart, my first marriage was falling apart, I was falling apart, and I think that invaded the song. And for me, the song is quite dark. And it's not about seduction, and it's not about love and tenderness, it's about surveillance and control. I'll be watching you. And I get some letters sometimes, you know, this is our song, my wife and I love this song, and we fell in love to this song, and we always play it on our, you know, anniversary, and I'm thinking, man, this is really sick. But I'm not saying that's wrong, because that was my intention, but you know, the song is quite dark for me, and there's no light at the end of the tunnel. It just goes back, and it's a big circle, and the guy is trapped in his obsessions, and he just simply can't get out of that. I think it's quite sad, actually. This song, as I said, was very successful in the 80s, and I think I'm safe in saying it was one of the songs that defined the 80s, and it was a perfect song for Reagan's America in a way, you know, that sort of idea of the Star Wars fantasy of protection and surveillance at the same time. So by accident I wrote a song for Ronald Reagan, so so we've done the first two verses. Let's go to the bridge now, where you would normally have some sort of release and some sort of change of heart. No such thing. So it's an F chord, right? 2, 3, 4. Every vow you breathe, every step you.
Sunflowers. Thank you.
We're about to sing, the singer realizes that he's made promises of love before and broken those promises, but he commits himself this time to make a promise that will last. And I think for men it's something that you mature into. I think it takes a lot of maturity to be committed to one person, and I am committed to one person, a person I love very much. But it's something that men have to learn. I think our genetic programming is such that our agenda is slightly different to those of women. You know, we make promises and have no intention of keeping them. We want one thing, you know. We have one thing on our minds. But then as you get older, you realize that you have to make a commitment because that your happiness depends on that. And, you know, our human nature really is no excuse for any kind of behavior. And I'm reminded of the film The African Queen with Katharine Hepburn and Humphrey Bogart. And at one point, Katharine Hepburn says to Humphrey Bogart, "Mr. Allnut, human nature is something we're put here to rise above." And I think that's a great put down for all men. So let's sing the bridge. 2, 3, 4.
I never made promises lightly, but there have been some that I've broken, and I swear in the days to left, we walk in fields of gold. We walk in fields of gold.
Okay, Dominic, it's your moment.
Thank you.
Okay, this next part of the show, I'm really looking forward to it. You'll see why in a minute.
But it's my destiny to be the king of pain.
And the reason is that I'm replacing one of the greatest piano players on earth with me. This is Kenny Kirkland, by the way. So, I'm a terrible piano player, but that's why I write songs. But I wrote this song at the piano, so I want to show you how terrible it is when songs start.
There's a little black spot on the sun today. That's my soul up there. It's the same old thing as yesterday. That's my soul up there. There's a black-eyed car in a high treetop. That's my soul up there. There's a flagpole rag, the wind won't stop. That's my soul up there. I have stood here before inside the pouring rain, with the world turning circles running round my brain. I guess I'm always hoping that you'll end this rain, but it's my destiny to be the king of pain.
Thank you. Well, I enjoyed that. I was in Jamaica and I was looking at the sun one day, and I noticed some sunspot activity, and the following conversation took place with my significant other Trudy, who was suffering me at the time. And I wrote down the conversation. Find it in my journal here. I say, there's a little black spot on the sun today, and Trudy waits expectantly for the payoff, and I say, that's my soul up there. And Trudy lifts her eyes to heaven and goes, there he goes again. The king of pain. So when I saw the black hat and the tree and the flag, there was no stopping me, you know. Anyway, we'll finish the song with the great Kenny Kirkland on piano. Actually, this song has also made me famous for writing really depressing lyrics with a very jolly tune, you know. So, in this next bit, if you do this, I'll do it anyway, you'll see what I mean. One, two, three.
There's a king on a throne with his eyes torn out. There's a blind man looking for a shadow of doubt. There's a rich man sleeping on a golden bed. There's a skeleton choking on a crust of bread. There's a red fox torn by a huntsman's pack. There's a black wingo with a broken back. I've stood here before inside the pouring rain, with the world turning circles running round my brain. Cause I'm always hoping that you will this rain. It's my destiny to be the king of pain.
Thank you. This next song is called Let Your Soul Be Your Pilot. And it was inspired largely by a very close friend of mine who had contracted the HIV positive. And a couple of years later it became fully blown AIDS. And the first time he went to hospital, I visited him, and I was really at a loss to know what to bring him. And I just read a book by a Buddhist monk called Sogyal Rinpoche. The book was called the Tibetan Book of Living and Dying, which is sort of an updated version of the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And I'd enjoyed this book very much, and it had brought me a lot of solace. The premise of the book is that dying is a process that we all need to be training for, in that we're all dying, whether we have AIDS or not. And I thought that was a good book to give him, and he loved the book, and he got a great deal of pleasure from it. That's all I want to say. This is about my friend. song was written in 1976. I just moved to London. It was the 25th anniversary of Queen Elizabeth's accession to the throne. It was also the year of punk and the Sex Pistols and anarchy and, you know, aggressive music and aggressive lyrics. And just to show you how in tune with the time I was, I wrote this song. Every time, no, what is it? I'll start again. I know now. No. I sing this song every night of my life and it just flew out of my head. I got it.
Though I tried before to tell her of the feelings I have for her in my heart, every time that I come near her, I just lose my nerve as I've done from the start. Every little thing she does is magic. Everything she do just turn me on. Even though my life before was tragic, now I know my love for her goes on. Do I have to tell a story of a thousand rainy days since we first met? It's always me that ends up getting wet. Every little thing she does is magic. Everything she do just turn me on. Even though my life before was tragic, now I know my love for her goes on. Up a thousand times a day and ask her if she'll marry me in some old-fashioned way. But my silent fears will grip me long before I reach the phone, long before my tongue has tripped me. Must I always be
up in my hotel room one morning and the window cleaner was cleaning my windows in the hotel. Roxanne, you don't have to put on. I thought, I've made it. Actually, I've made it. What, you on Valium or something? Wait. What was this, the slow version? All right. Must be the heat.
Seven weeks have passed now since she left me, and she shows her face to ask me how I am. She says the kids are fine, that they miss me. Maybe I could call babysit sometimes. She says, are you okay? I was worried about you. Can you forgive me? I hope that you'll be happy. I see. I'm so happy that I can't stop crying. I'm so happy I'm laughing through my tears. Star friend of mine, you see, I was worried about you. I heard you had another man. I wondered how you felt about it. I see. I'm so happy that I can't stop crying. I'm so happy I'm laughing through my tears. Saw my lawyer, Mr. Good News, he got me joint custody and legal separation. I'm so happy that I can't stop crying. I'm laughing through my tears. I'm laughing through my tears.
Thank you.
Okay, we have three verses there, which is basically, you know, setting up the situation. The guy has been left by his wife, and the two kids have gone, and he's obviously clearly unhappy. His friend's worried about him. The lawyer's got, you know, joint custody, legal separation, which simply doesn't make him happy either. And what happens in the middle eight, he goes for a walk, and he looks at the stars, and he sees, like any amateur astrologer, some sort of analog for his life in the stars. He chooses a star for himself, a star for the man who's run off with his wife, his wife and two kids. And something, as I say, something makes him smile. Something eases the pain, and he can't really explain it. A friend sees him again, and he says, there's something different about you, and he says, well, you can't live in the darkness all the time. So I haven't left this character stuck or trapped in his obsessions, like the character in Every Breath You Take. He's moved on, and I think for that reason it's a very positive song. So if we go to the bridge, you'll see what happens. 2, 3, 4.
I took a walk alone last night. I looked up at the stars to try and find an answer in my life. I chose a star for me. I chose a star for him. Chose two stars for my kids and one star for my wife. Something made me smile. Something seemed to ease the pain. Something about the universe and how it's all connected. The pockets full of Sunday fathers and melted ice cream. We try to do the best within a given time. A kid should be with his mother. Everybody knows that. But what can a father do but babysit sometimes? So that friend of mine is there. You look different somehow, see. Everybody got to leave that darkness sometimes, I see. I'm so happy that I can't stop crying. I'm laughing through my tears. I'm laughing through my tears.
Thank you. Okay, this song is another one of those songs that people identify me with. It was written in 76 or something. And it was the subject of a great sketch on Saturday Night Live. And I was in an elevator with Dana Carvey, and they start singing, you know, my songs to me and at me. And, the funny thing is, this happens to me almost every day of my life. And you know something? I really don't mind, because I'll be walking down the street in New York, and you know, construction workers will start singing Roxanne at me, and postmen and taxi drivers. Eddie Murphy sang it in 48 Hours. The first time it happened, I was, it suddenly went into the charts in England against all the odds, and we were playing in Stoke, which is in the Midlands in England. And I woke up in my hotel room one morning, and the window cleaner was cleaning my windows in the hotel. Roxanne, you don't have to put on it. I thought, I've made it. Actually, I've made it. It's a Chinese folk song. So, I mean, I sing this song every night of my life. I never tire of it. It's hard to sing, but I love it. All right. Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. Those days are over. You don't have to say about it through the night. Roxanne, you don't have to wear that dress tonight. Walk the streets for money. You don't care if it's wrong or if it's right. Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. I love you since I knew you. I wouldn't talk now to you. I have to tell you just how I feel. I won't share you with another boy. You know so put away your makeup. Told you once, I won't tell you again. It's a bad way. Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. I like Groucho Marx's quote, you know, never belong to a club that would have you as a member. I think I subscribe to that very dear. Honest for Brazil. I've been there many times. And I met the what I could best describe as a shaman who happens to have a degree in chemistry, actually. And he was explaining to me something. He was saying that sunlight has a lot of elements. It's composed of a lot of elements. And one of them is lithium. And as you know, lithium is a medication given to the depressed. It's a very successful drug. But it actually exists in sunlight. And at sunrise and sunset, you can look into the sun without damage. And the eye does not filter yellow light. So this lithium goes straight to the brain. So that's the reason why people should look at the sunset, why we get a great deal of solace and comfort from looking at the sunset or the sunrise. So I wrote a song called Lithium Sunset, which is basically an ode to this natural medication, which is available to all. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now feel my eyes, oh, lithium sunset. Oh, take this lonesome burden of worry from my mind. Oh, take this heart.
On the guitar, Mr. Dominic Miller. On the drums, Mr. Vinnie Kelly. On the keyboard, Mr. Kenny Cook. Now you gotta clap. This is on 2 and 4. It couldn't be easier. Oh.